Good evening, brothers and sisters. Come on in. We welcome you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we are so happy you decided to join us online this evening. I know some of you are just so upset that you didn't get a chance to go out to the church. I'm sure you weren't, but how we thank and praise God that you are online tonight. You know, in everything, God is working out good for those who love him, those who are the called according to his purpose. A few years ago, this would not have been an option for us on a cold, cold night like this. And how we thank and praise God that we have the opportunity to come online and to learn together, pray together, seek God's face together. Come in. I still see the numbers are crawling up bit by bit. Praise be unto God for each and every one of you who are coming online. We haven't had this kind of winter for a couple of years. Maybe we've gotten out of the habit. schools are closing. I last heard 350 schools are closing tomorrow. And they expect many more. And we want to keep all these people who have to be out there in our prayers. We saw so many this evening also on the news who didn't have heat in their homes. And we certainly want to pray for those who are out of doors and the pets who are out of doors. They said that many pets were dying because people were not taking good care of them. Bring your poodles in, your Rottweilers, whoever they are, whatever they are, and take good care of them. Amen. Come on in. Welcome. We're glad you're here. We had a wonderful time in the Lord's house on Sunday. And we had the Deltas and the AKAs, the Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority. Both of those were in worship together. It was a beautiful time in the Lord. Reverend Patton preached and did a great job. The music was powerful. God did a wonderful work in our midst. Well, we have this Sunday is our Legacy Sunday. And we want to encourage you to be there. Be in your place for our Legacy Sunday. There is, I was trying to show this. Maybe I need to come off so it can be on. For you to get your friends, your relatives, acquaintances, neighbors, co-workers, those straying members, see if you can get them to come to worship with us. There's the man of God right there, the Reverend Dr. John D. Tolbert. And we're grateful to God to see him today.
Well, good evening.
Good evening, sir. We missed you, and we're glad you're here today.
Well, thank you. Praise Jesus. Good evening, everyone. I think we're just about where we need to be. Before we get started, thank you, Dr. Bobo, for opening up for us. And thank you, Minister Patton, for bringing a mighty word on this past Sunday. Come on, Trinity family, just join me in showing Minister Patton some love. He brought a mighty word on Sunday. We're grateful for all of our guests that shared with us. To AKAs and the Deltas, and happy Founders Day to everybody who is celebrating Founders Day, to all of the Greek letter organizations. I think most of the ladies are right around this time. So happy Founders Day to your respective organizations. Come on in the room. Thank you all for praying for us. We were sharing with our brother-in-law this weekend for his anniversary. Grateful for family and family time. And so thank you for keeping it moving for us. And I know that the weather here has been terrible, but you know what? We inside tonight. Praise God. Praise God. I pray you are doing what you need to do to stay warm wherever you are. I pray you are doing what you need to do to stay warm. To those we have not had an opportunity to greet, Happy New Year to you and to yours, from our house to yours. Happy New Year. It's January the 16th. January the 16th. To God be the glory. The year is already moving, and I pray that it is moving in the right direction for you, that you are excited about what God is doing in your new year. And I think that for those of us who are football fans out here on these streets, Michigan is becoming the football capital of the world. Shout out to the national champions, Michigan Wolverines, and the Detroit Lions are on their way to the Super Bowl. Somebody said it couldn't be done, but he would have chuckled replied, amen. Anyway, we don't know if they're going to make it for sure, but you know what? They're on the right path, and we're just going to believe by faith that it's going down. And I'm rolling with them like four flat tires. All right, that's enough football talk. Let's talk about Jesus. And also, happy Martin Luther King Day to those of you we didn't have an opportunity to greet. I pray that you did something to celebrate the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s life in the capacity of service, or remembering him, listening to a speech, remembering some of the demonstrations, and doing something nonviolent. Amen. We are grateful for this man's life, and grateful for the practices that he has implored to help us to receive some of the liberties that we have. And again, we are grateful for the privilege to vote directly because of many of the things that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Has done to help us to get to this place and platform in our respective lives. And so, yeah, we got to pause to remember the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And injustice anywhere today is still a threat to justice everywhere. No matter what your color is, no matter what your context is, if you allow it to go down wrong, it's going to affect you. If it doesn't affect you, it's going to affect somebody that you love sooner or later. And so we applaud and grateful for his life. Tonight, we are continuing in our series, Blessed to Be a Blessing. I want you to know it, beloved. You are indeed blessed. You are blessed to be a blessing. And I pray that you would know it. I pray that you would celebrate the fact that God has blessed you to be a blessing. And we just give God praise that in 2024, we are blessed. Not that we're going to be blessed, but we are blessed. Not that we have been blessed, but we are blessed. We blessed right now. We blessed in the city. We blessed in the field. We blessed when we go. We blessed when we come. Amen. God has power and has given us power to cast down every stronghold, sickness and power. Sickness and disease, and cast it out of us because of the power of the Holy Spirit that we have in us. And so I pray that you know that you will not be blessed, and not that you have been blessed, but you are blessed right here, right now. Whatever you got going on, you are blessed. Even in the midst of grief, you are still blessed. Maybe you're grieving the loss of a parent. Maybe you're grieving the loss of a spouse. But will you also, in the midst of that grief, just thank God for the time that he's given you? Woo, thank you, Jesus. Maybe you're grieving the loss of a child, but thank God that you were able to have the child. Let's just thank God for the fact that in the midst of every trial, there is blessing in the midst of it. And God is blessing his people. Maybe you lost your job, but will you thank God that he gave you a job and that you were able to do so far with that job, all the things that you've all been able to accomplish? And you got to trust him, not the job. Amen. You got to trust God, not the market. You got to trust God, not your benefits. You got to trust God, y'all. And he has blessed you. And he's blessed you to be a blessing. So wait a minute. The things that God has done for you, he's done it for you for a reason, so that you can help somebody else. Can I just help? Listen to me. Praise God. Where the parents at tonight? Praise God that as reckless as your child might be, aren't you grateful tonight that you are in a position to help your child? Even if it's nothing more than offering them shelter, even if it's nothing more than help letting them come to your house and sit down for a ginger ale or whatever it is y'all drinking. Praise God that you are able to help and encourage your child in the midst of the situation that they may find themselves in. Maybe you don't have millions of dollars. Maybe you don't have a ton of help for them to pull from. But praise God that in the midst of the trial, there's still something to see where God is blessing, whether it be a child, whether it be a parent, whether it be a spouse, whether it be vocation, whether it be your health, whether it be your relationship status, whatever you got going on, God has blessed you to be a blessing to somebody else. And so, hey, praise God for where you are and what you got going on. And in the midst of that, God is giving you what you need to help somebody else. So we're going to continue this discourse tonight as we pick back up our thoughts regarding blessed to be a blessing. At the same time, while we're teaching tonight, I encourage you to get your temperature up. Bible says in Revelation chapter 3, God knows the works that we've done. He knows the things that we have done. He knows whether we are hot, whether we are cold. And he says, I wish that you were one or the other. But since you are like lukewarm water, neither hot or cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. And it is our intent this year, 2024, to help the body of Christ to get their temperature up and to do those things that are necessary for us to get our temperature up so that God does not spit us out of his mouth. We got to move from being lukewarm and giving God our leftovers to giving God our best, being on fire for God. And that's our prayer. That's our prayer that you would make a shift. Change from just giving God leftovers, what you got left, to intentionally investing into your spiritual life by what you do. God, I'm just going ahead and put it on out there. Amen. If you spend more time at work than you do with Jesus, something wrong with that. Something wrong with that. God gave you that job. If you're spending more time at Ford Field than you spend it with Jesus, something wrong with that. Something is wrong with that. As much as you might appreciate what them Detroit Lions doing, they don't know your name. They didn't wake you up this morning. They didn't start you on your way. They are not blessing you. You might have a moment of appreciation and ecstaticness because of what is happening. But please don't get it twisted. Please remember what side your bread is buttered on. And that comes from the Lord, not from no lion. Amen. All right. I'm done with that. If you're spending more time with your fraternity and with your sorority than you are with my Jesus, something is wrong with that. And I'm talking to the child of God. Amen. I ain't talking to the liars because liars do what they do. I ain't talking to the thugs and the pimps because thugs and pimps do what they do. I'm not talking to the harlots and the skeezers because harlots and skeezers do what they do. I'm talking to you as a child of God. If you are making more time for those things that are outside of your circumference as a child of God, something is wrong with that. And you need to get your temperature up. I don't know if skeezer is a bad word or not, but it's the only thing that I could think of at the time that was as less sensitive. But y'all know what I'm trying to say. Amen. And I ain't trying to be derogatory. I just want to get your attention to help you understand, hey, you got to make some investment in your spiritual life and get your temperature up. Stop giving God your leftovers and being lukewarm. Water that just sits becomes lukewarm, and it's either got to be heated up or cooled off. God does not want lukewarm water. He does not want lukewarm service. He don't want lukewarm worship. He don't want lukewarm prayer. He don't want lukewarm fellowship, and he does not want a lukewarm church. And that's where you come in, because you got to do what you need to do to get your temperature up, beloved. And so that's what we've been talking about all year. And another facet of getting your temperature up in this series, Blessed to Be the Blessing, is who are you fishing for? It's about being intentional. And as we are striving to be intentional, amen, that's where you got to have a Frank's list, because this is where God is using us intentionally to bless the kingdom of God. You are blessed to be a blessing. Blessed to be a blessing to who? Your friends, your relatives, your acquaintances, your neighbors, your colleagues, your coworkers, strange church members. Bless them for what? Ultimately, you want to help them to get back into relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, not with the church. Again, our issue or our promotion, our ministry, our teaching is not about the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is about Jesus Christ, because you can be right with the church and be wrong with Jesus. Amen. So I want you to be right with Jesus. And then a byproduct of you being right with Jesus is that you're going to do something for the church. Amen. The two go together. I've been saying that for years. I'm not going to stop saying that. The two go together. But it's got to be a certain way. Jesus Christ and then his church, not the church and then Jesus Christ, because you can fall out of love with the church. But if you love Jesus, then you're gonna deal with the church. I wish some adults would talk to me who are mature in the spirit. If you love Jesus, you can overcome church hurt. If you love Jesus, you will deal with a raggedy ministry leader. If you love Jesus, you will deal with somebody who you will put up with somebody who is antagonizing or frustrating in your ministry context, because you understand what Jesus has had to deal with you. And if Jesus has had to deal with you in those capacities, then he has tempered you to be able to deal with other people who are living in those type of capacities. Amen. So if you frustrated or frustrating, God has had to deal with you. If you are anal and God has had to deal with you, then you've got to learn how to deal with other people who are stuck in those positions. And that is what getting your temperature up is all about, helping you to realize that you are blessed to be a blessing to others. And if God can tolerate you, you ought to be willing to tolerate him. But you can't do that being in love with the church. You only can do that by being in love with Jesus Christ. And when you love Jesus, then you have relationship with the church. But if you have love for the church, you may miss your relationship with Jesus. I pray y'all getting this thing as we put it down. So get your temperature up is what we're talking about. Blessed to be a blessing as we talk about it tonight. The blessed practices were created as a simple tool to help bring the love of God to others. Your motivation is to help them know Jesus and experience eternal life. Jesus's mission was to seek and save the lost, but his simple strategy was friendship and blessing. And that's why you are blessed to be a blessing. Let's pray. God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you tonight for your love, your grace, your mercy, and your kindness. Thank you, God, for this, the day that you have made. We do rejoice, and we are glad in it. Thank you, God, for these principles that we started talking about in 2023. And now as we crossed over into 2024, God, we pray that you would continue to unpack these principles for us, that our ministry would be strengthened, that our church would be strengthened, that the body of Christ would be made better. That individuals who are not connected would be saved. God, I pray that you would revive the saved and save the wretched. In the name of Jesus tonight, I pray, Lord God, that you give us strength to teach, anointing to teach, power to teach, and to speak the truth with love tonight. So much so that our temperatures would be increased, that the thermostats would be turned up, that the thermometers, the numbers on the our spiritual thermometers would go up. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. All right. We've been talking about this strategy, the blessing strategy, and the B starts with beginning with prayer. The L starts with listening. And that's what we concluded last year on, the joy of listening and the blessing of listening. And tonight, I want to start, I'm going to deal with it 2 weeks, I know for sure, the blessing of eating together. Blessing of eating together. Everybody say eat. Let's eat. Let's eat. Blessing of eating together. And I want to make sure that we are coming through very clear. I'm going to take my time, because this is one of the key elements to our ministry in this season. We started it last year and gave more meat to it last year about Sunday dinner. And God, man, let me tell y'all something. God is so good, the way that he gives insight and then gives direction to fulfill the insight that he's given. I praise God for vision, because as we talk more about Sunday dinner, I knew that that's what God wanted us to do, but I didn't know exactly how that these things would come to play. I didn't know exactly how to talk about it. I didn't know exactly have recollection of exactly what the scriptures were saying, but now I do, and I'm so excited of how God has given revelation about what we're talking about, because it lets me know that I'm in the Holy Ghost and that I'm not just hauling off, making up stuff on my own or just trying to figure it out as we go. No, the Holy Spirit is with us. God is with us. He's leading and guiding. And let me just say this again. Where there is no vision, the people perish. But where there is no finance, the vision will perish. And I want to celebrate you, Trinity, for how you have been a blessing with your generosity to not only receive the vision, but also to finance the vision. And Sunday dinner is a part of that. We're getting ready to talk about the blessing of eating together tonight. Blessing of eating together tonight. Let's go to John chapter 12, reading verses 1 through 12. And we're going to hook up with Jesus. We're going to hook up with a couple of his friends at a Sunday dinner experience. It may not be Sunday, but let's just call it a Sabbath day experience, Sabbath day dinner. So they, of course, celebrated Friday, Saturday. We celebrate on Sunday because Jesus got up on Sunday. He was resurrected from the dead on Sunday, the first day of the week. That's why we worship on Sunday. Just in case any of y'all have wondered, why do we worship on Sunday and Jews worship on Saturday, or Seventh-day Adventists worship on Saturday? We worship on Sunday because Jesus was resurrected from the grave on Sunday. That's what we believe. That's our premise. And so that's why we worship on Sunday. That's why Sunday is our Sabbath day. Here, let's do it. Let's read. Let's eat. The next day, there was a wedding celebration in the village of Cana in Galilee. Jesus's mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the celebration. The wine supply ran out during the festivities, so Jesus' mother told him, "They have no more wine." "Dear mother, that's not our problem," Jesus replied. He says, "My time has not yet come." But his mother told the servants, "Do whatever he tells you to do." Verse 6, standing nearby were 6 stone water jars used for Jewish ceremonial washing. Each could hold 20 to 30 gallons. So Jesus told the servants, "Fill the jars with water." When the jars had been filled, he said, "Now dip some out and take it to the master of ceremonies." So the servants followed his instructions. When the master of ceremonies tasted the water that was now wine, not knowing where it had come from, though of course the servants knew, he called the bridegroom over. "A host always serves the best wine first," he said. "Then when everyone had a lot to drink, he brings out the less expensive wine. But you have kept the best until now." A gracious sign at Cana at Galilee and was the a gracious sign in the wedding of Cana of Galilee was the first time Jesus revealed his glory. And his disciples believed him. After the wedding, he went to Capernaum for a few days with his mother, his brothers, and his disciples. And so, beloved, what I want you to understand from this reading in John chapter number 12 is that we see the importance of eating together. We see the importance of Jesus coming together with his disciples at this wedding. There's a feast going on, the reception, of course, but the reception is not like our reception. It's not like a Western civilization reception. Our receptions are a couple hours after the wedding. And then, you know, you go get something else to eat because you're probably hungry. And then you go home. But that's not how receptions were in this context. Receptions in this context could be a week long. They could be a month long or longer. And it was the responsibility of the bridegroom to supply. Amen. That's a whole nother situation, because in our tradition, the bride's family is responsible for the reception if they can afford it. And in this context, the groom's family is responsible for the sustaining of the wedding reception. And so it could be, again, a week. It could be a month. However long it is, but in that time, the groom and his family had to provide the food, they had to provide the shelter, the accommodations, and of course, they had to provide the wine. Now, again, this ain't no open bar situation. This is a standard welcoming wine. The way that this, we talk about this wine in this context in John chapter 12, people act like it is licensed to have open bar. No, it is not a license to have an open bar. Jesus wasn't serving Jack Daniel, and Jesus wasn't serving Remy, and Jesus didn't have no goose. Amen. Jesus didn't have none of that. He wasn't popping no Smirnoff. I need y'all to understand that, because y'all just take stuff and y'all just haul off and take it out of context. No, it was a house wine that they had, because the water in itself was already terrible, so they wasn't drinking the water, but it was house wine. Drinking a couple of glasses of it couldn't make you drunk. Y'all need to understand that. It's a house wine. But the headmaster says, in essence, probably somebody from the bride's family says, hey, y'all done saved the best wine to later. Y'all off the chain. And so in the context, you see the bride's family, you see the groom's family, you see the community, because it is not suggested that Jesus is related to the bride or the groom, or that Jesus's mother is related to the bride or the groom. It's more of a community initiative. And that's what I want us to see, the blessing of eating together and celebrating together. Okay, that in this context, at this wedding, the community is there. All right, because why is that important? Even if they don't go to church, they still gonna come together as community. I hope y'all getting this. Even if they don't go to worship, they still gonna come together as community for the wedding. Well, so if they won't come to Jesus, Jesus will come to them. And so when Mary gives him these instructions, he says, hey, mama, chill out. My time ain't yet come. And yet at the same time, because his mama asks him to do something, he just goes ahead and he does it. He shows obedience to his mother. But at the same time, he takes this moment to reveal his power, to reveal his authority, to reveal his glory for the sake of promoting fellowship, family, and community. He changes the water into wine. But now here's the celebration. With Jesus being present, things will get sweeter. Things will get better. The best is yet to come. Yeah, they thought that they had something with him, but because they stuck with him, because he was there, he turned that which was seemingly already good, he made it even better. And that's what I want us to understand from Jesus' presence, and then along with the family. Now, in that same chapter, John chapter 12, we see where Jesus is hanging out with his friends, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. He's in the city of Bethany right prior to his crucifixion. Lazarus has just been resurrected from the dead. Remember, Lazarus died. Jesus found out about it, yet he didn't return back to Bethany. And so he allowed Lazarus to make sure that Lazarus was stinking dead, is what the Bible says. And so he says, for your sake, I didn't come. And so when he comes, he says, show me where you lay him. 4 days later, Jesus resurrects Lazarus from the grave. Now, when we come here to John chapter 12, Mary is fixing another dinner. Martha is fixing another dinner. Mary is worshiping. Lazarus is at the table. Once again, we see the importance of coming together and eating together, worshiping together. All right, but the focus is that they came for a Sabbath day dinner in this capacity. Here in this wedding, more than likely on a Sunday, Jesus and his crew are together. So the focus is the fact that they are together as community and family, eating together. I want you to see the centrality of the meal that is taking place in John chapter 12. Twice it is noted in John chapter 12 that Jesus is eating with people that he loves. Oh, wait a minute. Love and eating go together. I hope y'all write that down. Write it down. Love and eating go together. Write it down, y'all. Love and eating go together. Just think about it. People that you really love, you eating with. Come on now. People that you really love, you eating with. And y'all was doing that before I started talking about Sunday dinner. But think about it. Sunday dinner in our context has always been important. Amen. Let's go. Before we even had a movie called Soul Food, before we even had an official title called Sunday Dinner, it's called I'm Going to Mama's House. I'm Going to Big Mama's House. What day is it? It's Sunday. It's going down, y'all. Okay, because it's already special to us in our context. I need you to understand that. That didn't just happen in the 60s. That didn't just happen in the 50s. All right, that was already happening in Jesus' day, that the Sabbath day was already special, a special time for families. All right, so eating together, let's break it down. Following Jesus isn't meant to be comfortable. It's meant to be life-changing. There's no telling where he might send us and what he might lead us to do. To bless your neighbors, Jesus invites you to eat with them. To bless your friends, your relatives, your acquaintances, your neighbors, your colleagues, your coworkers, strange church members, he invites you to eat with them, encourages you to eat with them. Now, he wants to be there too, and it's your responsibility to make sure that Jesus gets to the table. Oh, my God. You got to make sure Jesus gets to the table. That's why we eating. We want to make sure that Jesus gets to the table, and you're his escort. You're his invitation to that table. You're his invitation to that conversation. That's why on Sunday, we're texting you conversation points and Sunday dinner conversation points so that you can have some pointed conversation, some direct conversation on Sunday dinner, so you can find out where your friends are, where your relatives are, what their thoughts are. It's not intrusive. It's not too much. Amen. It ain't all spiritual, super duper spiritual and spooky. It's just really so you can introduce Jesus to the conversation at dinner. I mean, don't get me wrong. You can talk about Cat Williams, but come on, let's talk about Jesus. You can talk about what the preacher talked about. Y'all can have roasted preacher for dinner. A pastor could have did this. He could have did that. The minister could have did this, could have did that. Choir could have did this. Choir could have did that. Director could have did this. Director could have did that. Did you see what Sister So-and-so had on? See, brother, y'all can do all that. I mean, but King, would you please bring Jesus to the dinner table? Would you please talk about Jesus at your dinner table? I mean, and that's what the Sunday devotion is about. When you get that Sunday dinner devotion, you are bringing Jesus to the table. He needs you to be his escort to the table. We're going to talk more about that as we go. And so in the blessing strategy, I'm sure you have a list of favorite places to eat. Those are the places everyone in your friend group or your family gets excited about. You know, Cheesecake Factory. Ooh, come on, let's be real. It might be the Coney Island. Ooh. Amen. We from the deep. All right. So understand it doesn't have to always be a fancy spot, y'all. It don't always have to be Ruth Chris. It don't always have to be the Yard House. It don't always have to be somewhere in Troy. It can be in the Yak. Oh, how we miss L and J. Oh, how we, I don't even know. L and J, wherever y'all at, y'all come on back whenever y'all get ready. Or somebody, I might be speaking this into somebody's life. We need a new soul food spot in the Yak, and it might be you who God is calling to open it so we can have a place for Sunday dinner. Maybe the Legacy Center. Lord, in the name of Jesus, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Anyway, there are places where everyone likes to go to eat. All right. And you can have the argument about why your spot is the best spot, why your city is the best food city, or your spot in the city is the best. Now, you know, Ashley and I have these discussions all the time. I'm a Cheesecake Factory person. I just like it. I don't really have to give no explanation about why I like it. I just like it, period. Okay. But that's not her thing. Ashley wants the greasy spoon. I mean, she wants the hole in the wall. She wants the letters to be out. She don't want all the lights on the sign to be working. She wanted the apron on the person in the back to be a different color. I mean, you know, she wanted all greasy and dingy. I mean, that ain't me. You know, I can be bougie from time to time. I'm okay with that. I can admit it. I'm matured. I don't have a problem saying, you know, I want my fork and my knife and my spoon on a nap. I ain't got a problem admitting it, y'all. But my wife, that ain't her thing. She won't have to, you know, pick up the spoon. She want to clean it when she get it. A greasy spoon. And we could go on and on and on and on having these conversations about what spot is the best spot, who offers the best this, who offers the best that. And that's part of our conversation when we go out to eat. And I'm sure, you know, you had those same contexts and conversations as well. The point is that when you get into those spaces, don't forget to talk about Jesus. I think Americans have a love affair with food. You know, we got food channels, we got food blogs. Shout out to the multiplicity of chefs that we have at our church. We always talk about the doctors. We always talk about the lawyers and the judges. We talk about, you know, those upper level managers. God bless y'all. Amen. But Trinity got some chefs. Y'all hear me? Shout out to the chefs, the professional ones with the white hats and the undercover chefs that don't have the license and don't have all y'all still chef. We got some wonderful, wonderful cooks at our church. And they doing the doggone thing with on the side, the small businesses. I'm blessing your businesses in 2024. I speak life over your initiatives and your businesses in 2024 to all the chefs. Do the doggone thing. But it speaks to the fact that we have a love affair with food in our world. And despite all of that, we often fail to recognize the power of eating. God, the Bible is full of eating experiences. Your favorite movie has an eating scene. Your favorite soap opera gonna always have some type of dinner or dinner breakfast scene. Brunch is becoming the new scene. You know, they're doing mimosas and all that stuff. All right, that's cool. But listen, and everything that you enjoy, you're going to see an eating scene. And it's normally the biggest scene. I mean, y'all know one of my favorite actors is Eddie Murphy. And in every one of his movies, you're going to have an eating scene because it just shows, it connects. The power of eating connects the audience to the actor, so on and so forth. And guess what? That's biblical, because in every dramatic experience in the Bible, you see that there's a context of eating and capacity of eating. And so Jesus does that on purpose, specifically the experience of eating with someone. He's showing that when he eats with someone or he feeds someone, he's showing us the power of eating. Something special happens when we gather at the table. Lord, I got a Sunday morning feeling on a Tuesday night. Something special happens when we gather at the table. Some things are just better together. Amen. Like peanut butter and jelly. Ain't y'all agree with that? And this is also true of the two practices of listening and eating. Now, previously we talked about listening. I want y'all to just see real quick where listening and eating go together. If you got listening and you got eating, man, you got a real strong connection, because the two go together. They make a powerful 1-2 punch. First, because neighbors seldom share meals together. Friends, relatives, acquaintances. They're too far and in between. Every time you get with somebody to go to eat outside of your spouse or your significant other, or who you want to be your spouse or significant other, you know, it's far and in between. You know, you might have Sunday dinner, you may have a Thanksgiving, you might have Christmas, and then you may not do anything until Memorial Day, right? You may not do anything until the 4th of July, right? So that's far and in between. And I want you to see that if you love somebody, then there's a significance of eating with them often and in having community with them often. Now, these cell phones done messed us up, all right? Because, you know, now we can just text. Now we can just call. But you remember the Sunday dinner experience in its origin was the only time that the Black family had to come together. Now, white folks, same way. Other cultures are the same way. You know, they value Sunday dinner just like we do. It's not by Black. It's not by white. Sunday dinner is not by Italian. All right. In every one of our cultures, eating together is epic. In every one of our cultures, that's why it's a biblical principle. It's cross cultural. It doesn't matter what color you ascribe Jesus to be. He ate. And it doesn't matter if you want Jesus to be Black, if you want Jesus to be Italian, if you want Jesus to be white, if you want Jesus to be Jewish, he's all them things, right? But at the end of the day, he ate, all right? And he ate with people to show us, to teach us the power of eating together. And so when we have these meals in our individualistic society, hospitality is seen as an extravagant gesture of goodwill. We got to know that. And some of you have the gift of hospitality. Some of us don't. But it's always good to be nice to people. It's always good to be inviting because we want God to be inviting to us. Thank you, Jesus. We want God to give us a seat at the table. Amen. So we got to be willing to do the same thing. We have to be willing to give what it is that we want to get. Second, when we focus on the meal, focus off the meal is centered on good conversation to let you know your neighbor, your friend, your relative, acquaintance. It comes across as a tremendously generous act. So not only is it hospitable, but it's generous, all right? Because if you're inviting someone to your home, now that's a different situation. you know, you probably gonna provide that type of meal. But as I said, our issue, or not issue, but our invitation is Dutch. If you're going out, you know, everybody for everybody. Don't have no one bill sitting there talking about you owe this and you owe. No. Unless the Lord leads you to do that, and it's one bill, then fine. Praise God. And I've been out on some Sunday dinners, and I've done it. Others have done it. Praise God. We appreciate that. But that's not the intent. You go Dutch. That means you get a bill, you get a bill, you get a bill. Don't y'all be like these folk out here. Get to hide when the bill comes. Like, now you done sat there. You done ordered all them appetizers. You done ordered all them drinks. I don't drink. I don't drink. And so when I'm sitting here like, man, I know I ain't spent no $700 on no drink. I know this Canada Dry ain't cost no $700. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? But then when it comes time to pay the bill, you know, folk get to disappear. Folk got to go to the bathroom all of a sudden. Like, oh my God, I didn't even know. What did you have? Negro, you know what you had. So don't even get involved in that when you go out with church folk. Just tell them, hey, we going out Dutch. Pastor already said it's Dutch. You get a bill. Now, if the Lord leads you to sponsor the meal, take care of it, then y'all go ahead and y'all do that. All right. But initially, it's the initiation is a Dutch invitation. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. So we see that it's generous. We see that it is a wonderful gesture. And at the end of the day, much of Jesus' ministry, and here's the I'm in Bible study, whoever trying to text me. In our individualistic society, Jesus' ministry involved a conversation around a table. I want y'all to please don't miss that. Much of Jesus' ministry involved conversation around the table. In the book of Luke alone, there are 10 stories of Jesus dining and talking with various people. Active listening coupled with a good meal can catapult a casual acquaintance into a growing friendship. And we see that throughout the New Testament of our faith. So I encourage you to eat. Not surprisingly, some of the strongest examples of the power of eating together come from Jesus. Throughout scripture, we see him eat with people. But if I ask you to list all the ways Jesus blessed the people around him during his time on earth, I'm guessing eating with people wouldn't be on it. Why? Because first of all, people going to say, when we talk, what did Jesus do? We're going to talk about his teaching. We're going to talk about his healing. We're going to talk about his miracles. Woo! He turned things around, gave sight to the blind, hearing to the hearing impaired, walking to the lame, opened up blind eyes, rose the dead, right? He did all those things, walked on the water, died on the cross, and even came back to life himself, right? But, you know, in the meantime, between time, you do know he ate. And he ate with others. And that's a part of how Jesus blessed and saved the world, was by eating. Eating was central to Jesus's mission of loving others and showing them God's love. In fact, much of his ministry centered around meals. Let's make sure you get this. And if y'all don't have the handout, I want you to write it down. He performed his first miracle at a wedding feast. That's what we read today. One of the most well-known miracles was Jesus feeding how many? 5,000 on the hill. That's John 14. The night before his crucifixion, he, with his closest friends, his disciples, had a meal. We call it the Lord's Supper, or the Last Supper, in Luke 22. And after this, he shared breakfast on the beach with his disciples in John 21. Amen. This is why we love fish, because that's what Jesus was cooking. Jesus was cooking fish on the beach. After the disciples had come off the water, Jesus was there cooking fish on the beach. And this is where Jesus and Peter have the exchange, Simon by Jonah, lovest thou me. All right. So all of Jesus's, not all, many of Jesus's contacts with his disciples and most pivotal moments involve a meal. Eat together. Eating together was an affirmation of that person's value. Amen. You don't just eat with anybody, right? When you eat with somebody, when you invite somebody to dinner, it suggests then that you value that person. You have an appreciation for their dignity. You have an appreciation for their worth. You are saying, you know what? You know, you are somebody. That's why even feeding the homeless, man, and this is your if you're a member of our church, you need to know that this is one of your pastor's passions. There are a whole lot of issues in our community, even like the warming centers, right? So, you know, our city, we needed warming centers. Unfortunately, I was out of town, didn't get that information that they needed warming centers. And if they still need more, then we'll do what we need to do to make that happen. But there are so many issues that we can't address, right? You know, there's homelessness, and there are mental issues in our community, mental health. There are so many challenges in our community that we just can't address, right? But one thing that we can address is that nobody has to be hungry. We can do that. We can address that. And feeding people is one of the things that Jesus did. And I believe that we should do that. You know, maybe I can't give you $1,000, but I can give you a meal, right? If you're out, and if my family is going to eat, then whoever's in that community that can't eat should also be able to eat. And so I'm praying, Darrell, that y'all would embrace this, because when you feed somebody, you're saying to that person, you got value. You don't need to dig in this garbage can. You got some dignity. And even if you don't feel like you have no dignity because you with me, I'm saying you got dignity. And not only do you have dignity and value, but you got some worth. You don't eat this trash out this trash can. Come on, let's get something to eat. Let's get something real. All right, because at the end of the day, I don't know who you are. You could be Jesus. And I ain't going to let my Jesus just sit here and eat out no garbage can. That's how you know somebody really, really hungry. Now, my niece says that, you know, some of these people out here on the streets, on the corners are paid actors. Okay, and that may be true, right? That may be true. But when you actively see somebody that's hungry, then that person deserves your compassion. I ain't talking about the person asking for money, but the person asking for food. Because if you give them some food, man, they're going to have some appreciation because you gave them what they need. Not giving them money to go buy drugs, not giving them money to go buy alcohol, not giving them money to go do whatever, pay off no debt, none of that. But when you come in contact with somebody who genuinely appreciates you giving them something to eat, that might be Jesus up in there. Because he said, when I was hungry, you fed me. All right, I'm going to leave that alone. But that's what eating together, feeding the hungry gives them value, dignity, and worth. And so who you ate with indicated who you loved and considered to be a part of your social class. So wait a minute. When Jesus, and I will get to this here, and when Jesus ate with the tax collectors in Matthew 9, when he was getting calling Matthew, the whole community went up in on fire, in shambles. Because Jesus was eating with these wretched thugs. And they couldn't believe that the teacher was eating with these people. But he was saying to them, they don't give me value, but I give them value. They don't give me dignity, I give them dignity. They don't give me worth, but I'm giving them worth. Amen. 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 I hope y'all get this thing. So when you eat with somebody, you're considered, you love, when you eat with someone who you love and considered to be a part of your social class, not theirs. That's why it was so scandalous to the religious leaders when he frequently ate with the lowest and most hated people of the day. Respectable rabbis didn't eat with those who weren't part of the good people group, part of those who didn't go to the Lord's church. Amen. One of the things I miss about my first church is that we were in the hood, but right across the street from the bar. And I would go up into that bar. It was called the Grenadier. Some of y'all who understand the East Side, Mac and McDougal and Gratiot, you understand the Grenadier. Man, I would go up in there. They had some good food up in that Grenadier. But the saints couldn't understand. Pastor, what you doing up in that bar? I ain't in the bar. I'm in the Grenadier. It's got a name, y'all. And I need to meet the people up in here. That's why they ain't breaking into our cars and stealing stuff, because I got a relationship with these people who coming into the Grenadier. Amen. And so I want you to understand, you know, just because God has been good, don't forget where you came from. Amen. Please don't forget what it feels like to be in an enclosed space where there's only one exit. Don't forget where the Lord has brought us from. But in the text, they couldn't understand why Jesus was eating with these detestable individuals, these tax collectors. And what makes this encounter even more captivating is the fact that the tax collector Matthew was writing about who he was talking about was himself. Matthew is giving you an account of his own story, his own value of how Jesus basically came to his house and how Jesus ate with his friends. And that's when Matthew started to follow Jesus. I love how he tells the story. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. Now, Matthew telling his own story. And so he says, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me, he told him, and Matthew got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. And when the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with sinners?" And on hearing this, Jesus said, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick." And what this means is that I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have not come to call the righteous. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. And I pray, y'all, that we get this thing and that we implore Sunday dinner and eat together, because it's not the fact that God deserves sacrifice. He deserves mercy. We need mercy. Not sacrifice. Oh my God. He wants us to make sure that we understand why he came and why he's connected with us. We need his mercy. And then that will lead to us giving him sacrifice. He doesn't need our sacrifice first and then mercy. You need to know what you give him sacrifice for. And so mercy, mercy, mercy. When we eat, it's because God has given us mercy. When you sit down at the table and give grace, it's because God has given you mercy. The next piece of chicken you eat, it's because, not because God's been gracious, it's because he's been merciful. And I know sometimes we get that thing confused, but when we receive it, it's mercy. And we've got to say our grace over the fact that he's given us mercy. When you eat, it's because God has been merciful to you. You don't deserve it. You do not deserve the food you're getting ready to eat, whether it's low class, high class, no class, whether it's a silver spoon, gold spoon, or a plastic spoon, something sweet. Thank you, Jesus. Whatever it is, you better tell God thank you, because he's giving it to you out of his abundance of mercy. Every morsel of food you have ever eaten in your life has been because of the mercy of God. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have not come to call the righteous. Jesus did not come to heal people who are already healed. They don't need a doctor. He didn't come to save people who are already saved. They don't need a savior. He came to find those who were lost. And he proposes these moments, orchestrates these moments of eating with individuals who need him. So yes, when we go to Sunday dinner, I want everybody out to come to the Sunday dinner. No, it doesn't matter if that person came to church or not. It doesn't matter if that person believed in Jesus or not. They prime candidates to be at the Sunday dinner experience. Thank you, Jesus. He wants us to have that experience, y'all. Matthew 9, check it out for yourself. So eating together. Now in Jesus' day, tax collectors were considered to be the scum of the earth, and tax collectors worked for the Roman Empire. Most Jewish people considered them traitors because they made money by overcharging their own people. So tax collectors were seen but rarely spoken to, kind of like people from the IRS. I'm just playing. Yeah, my sister worked for the IRS. And so notice the first thing Jesus did after Matthew said yes to follow him wasn't to enroll Matthew in a class on how to become a disciple. He didn't challenge him to start studying the Bible or memorizing scripture. Those would have been vitally important assignments. But instead, what Jesus did is that he simply went to Matthew's house to eat. Whew. Volumes, y'all. Volumes, volumes. You want to get to know somebody? You need to eat with them. You want to get to know somebody? Have conversation with them. And we can't just do that on Sunday morning with high and by. We need to get to know each other. If we're going to be family, let's be family for real. And Sunday dinner is one of those initiatives that helps us to become real family, so that when you hurt, I hurt. When you rejoice, I rejoice. But not just from the top down, but everybody in the middle. That's family. That's family. I pray y'all get this thing. I pray that it's making sense of why we need to connect and why we need to eat. And who else joins them for this meal when we consider Matthew? Even more tax collectors, along with a whole group of people referred to as sinners. The people from the hood came to Matthew's house for dinner. Everybody else who had been excommunicated, everybody else that had been marginalized, came to Matthew's house for dinner because they hung together. Amen. Matthew's family was there. Matthew's cousins was there. Butternut and Pork Chop and Pookie and Ray Ray and Puff Puff. All of them was there at the house. And they hadn't even encountered Jesus. But because Jesus came to Matthew's house, Lakeisha and them, I'm sorry, we got a Lakeisha. But y'all understand, Chinook Nook, Cluck Luck, Kaneek Neek, Mock Mock Mock, all of them was at Matthew's house for dinner because they ate together. And when Jesus came to Matthew's house, he encountered all of the family. And that's how real change takes place. That's how real encounters take place. So it's not about the church trying to be more real. You can't get more real than you do at dinner. Everybody eat. Everybody burp. Everybody push away from the table. It's real. That's where real conversation takes place. That's where authentic conversation, authentic people, not in church, not in the worship experience, at the house. Amen. I'm encouraging y'all to do Sunday dinner because Jesus did it. Jesus goes to Matthew's house and encounters not only Matthew, his family, but the term other sinners are there. And in Jesus' day, it was a catch-all term for people who were not religious or who were not involved in illicit lifestyle. And so like Jesus encountered the crowd at Matthew's house, it was a vertebral moment of who's who of the unacceptable. And we as believers ought not be ashamed to eat with people that we're trying to connect with. It is my prayer that yes, the wretched get saved, but I'm praying that the saved get revived. And that's where eating comes to place. That's why we got to do Sunday dinner, y'all. I got to wrap up and we'll come back. We'll talk more about this next week. But, you know, let me ask you a question. Have you had Sunday dinner with anyone yet? Have you had Sunday dinner with anyone new? How many times are you going to pass that church and you see them doing this and you see them doing that and you saying, man, I want to know who that person is. Now, come on, leaders. Where y'all at? It's been 13 years. How is it, leaders, deacons, deaconess, trustees, how is it that I know their name, but you don't know their name? That means you need to do Sunday dinner with somebody. Yep, I'm calling you out. Shots fired. Boom, boom, boom. Why? Because if we're going to be family, let's do it for real. Let's do it. Let's connect. Don't let that young lady walk past you and you say, you know what? I've seen her somewhere. Did she go to your church? Amen. And it's not a romantic moment. And don't be hitting on them either. Amen. Take them out so you can get to know who the people are. Your family, their family. This ain't no one-on-one situation. It's families. We're not talking about anything outside of fellowship, church family fellowship. Removing any sniffling of hookup, connecting. That ain't what I'm about. I'm trying to help us be church family. And that's where fellowship comes in. We no longer do the Sunday dinner after church or the fellowship dinner at another church at 3 o'clock. We don't do that no more. Okay. So we got to shift. We got to change, but we still can do Sunday dinner. It's just got to be initiated by you. So I'm expecting our leaders to buy into this. Deacons, deaconess, your families, trustees, your families, and taking our new family members out, connecting with them, making them feel welcome, making them know, hey, we are glad that you are part of this family, and we want you to know who we are as your leaders, but we want to know who you are because we're leading you. Amen. Oh, y'all should be saying something. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Y'all ain't saying nothing. That's all right. I'm going to keep on going here. All right. So Sunday dinner, that's what we're going to talk about next week. When we come back for Bible study, we're going to talk about exactly what Sunday dinner should be, how it's orchestrated, and we'll wrap up talking about how to bless somebody else through eating. Okay. All right. You are blessed, beloved. to be a blessing. And Sunday dinner is one of the ways that God has given us as a church family to encounter these processes. Come on in, Reverend Doctor.
Yes, sir. We want to remember that this Sunday, there will be dinner after worship, and we invite everybody to become a part of that, to register for that. Our link has been sent to our emails, and so we want to encourage you so they can make sure that we have food for everybody and we know who's coming. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Sunday dinner is a wonderful thing. Thank you, Pastor, for keeping that before us, and I know that we're going to grow stronger as a result of getting to know one another and loving on one another in a whole different way.
Even thugs got to have Sunday dinner, Doc.
Even the thugs, that's right.
Even thugs got to have Sunday dinner.
There were no questions today.
No question.
No, everybody just said amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Well, I'm going to go. Let me just leave you with this story. I was on a plane yesterday, and scrolling through the movies on the plane, and I came across something called Fast and Furious. And I've seen several of the movies in Fast and Furious. And, you know, Vin Diesel and all these other people, they're doing what they do. But there was one thing that made every movie of Fast and Furious, and there's 10 altogether. And in every one, they had a Sunday dinner, a picnic, a barbecue. Because no matter what your lifestyle, no matter what your situation, whether you're right with the Lord or not, you're going to have dinner. You're going to value your dinner, and you're going to value your family. And as the body of Christ, I pray that we would value the mercy that God has given us and the opportunity that we can have to eat together. God bless you.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this wonderful word today that draws us closer to one another and closer to you. Help us, Lord, to get out of our comfort zone where we are by ourselves and don't want to be bothered. But help us, Lord God, to reach out to others, to love on them, to get to know them, to encourage people. Because some of them, Lord, are right around us. We don't know them, and they're going through their own secret storm. We pray that you will help us to help lift people when they are broken and hurting. Strengthen your people. Help us to be what you want us to be so that we can break down any barriers that people might be saved. We love you, God. We pray that you bless those who are at home and sick. We pray, Lord God, for those in the hospitals, those who are bereaved. We pray your hand would be upon them, that the blessings of the Lord would be upon your people. We love you, our God, and we pray that you will help us to raise our temperature, that we might reach people on fire for you in Jesus' mighty name. And Lord, we thank you for victory in this. Amen. Praise him!